not the baddest bitch you like. Ain't my fault that I'm out here getting loose. Gotta blame it on the goose. Gotta blame it on my juice, baby. Ain't my fault that I'm out here making news. I'm the pudding in the proofs. Gotta blame it on my juice. Yeah, 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 yeah. Blame it on my juice. Blame it on my juice. Yeah, 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 yeah. Blame it on my juice. Blame it on my juice, baby. No, I'm not a snack at all. Look, baby, I'm the whole damn meal. Baby, you ain't being slick. Don't dare try to cop a feel. The juice ain't worth the squeeze if the juice don't look like this. Please don't make me have to take your bitch. If I'm shining, everybody wanna shine. Yeah, I was born like this, don't even gotta try. You know. I like shouting, they get better over time. You know. Heard you say I'm not the baddest bitch you like.
Awesome. Hi, everyone. Welcome to Explore Interests, Help People Be Well. We're excited to have you all here today. I'd love to recognize everyone here who's experiencing Step Up for the first time. Welcome, welcome. Tell us where you're tuning in from in the chat and what you're excited to gain from this session today. So I see Nashville, Dallas, LA, sunny slash rainy LA, Atlanta, Irvine. Welcome. So nice to see you all. New York City, Denton, Texas, Charlotte, North Carolina, LA. Hi, Lulu. So good to see you. Chicago. Nice. What a good representation. I so look forward, and I think I can speak for everyone here. We look forward to getting to know you more. I'd love to introduce my team, my lovely team, Young Adult Programs, as your guides as you explore your interests and throughout your journey to success at Step Up. I'm Sophia, the director of Young Adult Programs, and I'm tuning in from LA today.
Hello, everyone. I'm Jess Mara, the Young Adult Programs Manager, and I'm tuning in from Charlotte, North Carolina.
Hi, everyone, and I'm Ajin. I'm tuning in from Springfield, Illinois, and I'm a recruitment associate.
Hello, everyone. My name is Elizabeth Rojas, and I am the data science associate for this team. And before we get started, I do have a couple of friendly reminders. We'd love to ask that everyone take a moment and adjust their display name to reflect three things: your name, your role, and the pronouns that you use. It's important for you to put down your role, whether you are a young adult, if you are between the ages of 18 and 23, or a mentor, so that we can sort you into the correct breakout rooms later. We would also love if everyone who is able to turn on your cameras, please do so. Even though we're not physically in person, we'd love to create that feeling, and it supports us in creating an intimate, safe, and brave space for everyone. All participant mics will be on mute until we go into our breakout sessions, so feel free to add your positive comments and all your reactions in the chat box at the bottom of your screen. As a reminder, we will be recording the session to share out with the folks who are not able to be here today. Additionally, if you need any support with anything at all throughout the event, please feel free to message Aja in the chat.
Thanks, Elizabeth. Our hope for our time together is that you all learn how a multitude of roles in various industries can align toward a common interest, helping people be well, and how to create a career path by following your interests, values, and skills with the help of our mentors today. We will start with a quick icebreaker game, then hear from our panel of interest experts. You'll then have the opportunity to ask questions, and we'll go into breakout rooms and do some mentoring and networking. I suggest you have your LinkedIn profile open and ready for that to connect with the members of your breakout rooms. We'll then return for a larger group reflection and then go over some exciting announcements. Mentors, your role is to model participation by having your camera on, being present, engaging in the chat, and sharing career advancement tips and resources with the Young Adult Programs community. I'm going to pass to my lovely Jess Mara to lead us through our icebreaker activity.
Thank you, Sophia. All right, so we are going to get started warming up with the icebreaker, and the name of the game is Guess the Job That Is Helping People Be Well. So we're going to put some clues as to what the job title could be on the slide, and then you can put your guesses in the chat. Everybody ready? All right, let's get started. So this first person values a healthy community. Some of their interests are goal setting and action planning, nutrition and exercise science. Some of the strengths and skills that they possess are exercise, program design, and evaluation, trained to provide cholesterol and blood pressure screenings, motivational interviewing techniques, and counseling individuals from diverse backgrounds. And the mindset they have is step by step. So drop your guesses in the chat. What do we think this job title is? No wrong answers. That's a tough one. I'll give you a hint. Nutrition and exercise science is a big part of this one, as well as a healthy community. Nutritionist coach, wellness coach. Love that. We can go ahead and show the answer. The answer is a wellness program coordinator, a health coach. So yes, like I said, all of those things tie into that. So a wellness program coordinator. Awesome, that one was tough. Okay, so this next person values an organized access to life, enhancing care. Interests are clear skin and fresh face, hint, hint, efficiency and organization and relationship building. Some of the strengths and skills they possess are knowledge of medical office management systems and procedures, excellent time management skills and ability to multitask and prioritize work, social perceptiveness and service oriented, excellent written and verbal communication skills, and their mindset is, I can help you. Let's drop those guesses in the chat. Dermatologist, esthetician. Nice, good guesses. We can go ahead and show the answer is dermatology assistant. Awesome, that one was a little bit easier. Nice. All right. And for our last position, this person values spreading awareness of health promoting brands and products. Their interests are exercising with others, meeting new people, and sharing passion about healthy living, branding, marketing, and partnerships in social media, and testing new Instagram or TikTok trends. Mm-hmm. Some of those strengths and skills are prospecting, landing and maintaining partnerships, positive can-do attitude, ready to take on the day and represent brands in a responsible way, be able to adapt to different types of personalities, manage and execute weekly customer retention campaigns and outreach. Their mindsets are, I love this and you will too. What are we thinking? Health, wellness, influencer, great guess. Awesome. Any other guesses? All right. This one is definitely a tricky one as well, but The answer is lifestyle brand ambassadors. So even if you didn't guess the exact name, that's the whole point of the game, is to give some insight on some new positions that you maybe haven't heard of before. So take note and look them up later. So fun. Thank you all for playing and participating, and passing back to you, Sophia.
Awesome. Thanks, Jess Mara. Sorry to stump everybody. Those were some really great guesses, and some hard titles. Anyway, I'm excited to introduce our Explore Interest panel tonight. I'm really excited to be moderating this panel and learning more from our interest experts. So our first panelist is Dr. Carmen Gutierrez. Dr. Carmen Gutierrez is a family medicine doctor in Downey, California, and is affiliated with multiple hospitals in the area, including Kaiser Permanente, Downey Medical Center, and Chino Valley Medical Center. She received her medical degree from Geisel School of Medicine at Dartmouth and has been in practice for more than 20 years. Everyone, give Dr. Carmen Gutierrez a warm welcome in the chat, please. Welcome. Our next panelist is Andrea Bahamondes. Andrea is a successful entrepreneur, professional certified coach with a master's degree in applied positive psychology, and she is the founder and head coach at Bloom, a coaching firm that offers mental health care for non-clinical clients. Hi, Andrea. So nice to see you. Welcome, welcome. And finally, my dear Terry Walters. Terry Walters is the best-selling cookbook author of Clean Food, Clean Start, Eat Clean, Live Well, and most recently, Nourish: Plant-Based Recipes to Feed Body, Mind, and Soul. She is a highly sought-after educator, consultant, and speaker, and has been teaching plant-based cooking and wellness to audiences all over the world for over 20 years. She is a dedicated chef, coach, and advocate, sharing her knowledge and passion for making healthy change in the way we eat and live. Welcome, panelists. Hello. Thank you for being here with us today. I'm so excited to ask you some questions we have prepared, as well as any that come from the audience today. So, audience, if you have some questions, there will be a Q&A section at the end. You could also send them to Jess Mara. Jess Mara will send them to me, and we'll get those during the Q&A session too, if you don't want to raise your hand. But my first question I would love all of you to answer is to know more about the work that you do. What impact, how are you helping people be well? Terry, can we start with you? How do you help people be well?
Yep, you can start with me. I think one of the things I love about what I do is that it's so varied. So on one day, I could be sitting in or teaching a class, a cooking class, and another day I could be sitting one-on-one with a client. I run a women's group as well, so we're supporting each other and creating that dialogue and bringing our wisdom together and facilitating that kind of community. There's so many different things that I do, and sometimes when you're, standing in front of a group speaking, you don't really know how your words are landing. And it's not until I get back and I get an email where someone says, "What you said made such a difference to me, and I was finally able to start eating something fermented," right? Or all of a sudden, "Your book was the thing that got me taking care of my health, and I have done a, complete 180." And so I get these emails that are like, just send me. It's just the greatest thing ever. And so I do a lot of different things. And I think what I like about the variety and what I do the most is I learned really early on that where I excelled was helping people who might not be familiar with plant-based eating, who are going there for the first time, taking those baby steps. Someone once said to me, "Oh, you need to move to this part of the country where everybody is like you." And I thought, well, that'd be really cool for me, but like, then nobody needs me there. And so being someplace where I was kind of like the black sheep, where I had something to offer that others ne didn't necessarily know, and were kind of looking at me like, "I'm not really sure about this." it forced me to present my passion in a way that made it accessible to people. And that information came back to me and helped me create this whole career path, just knowing where I excel and the audience that I can reach really well. Because if there's one thing I've learned in this career, it's that we can't be everything to everyone. Nobody can. And so knowing what you have to offer and the audience that can receive it well is super important.
I love all of that. Thank you for kicking us off, Terry. And what bravery it takes to be the Black sheep in your community.
Yeah. Don't you think we all kind of feel like the Black sheep in our community sometimes? I mean, I think that's human nature, imposter syndrome or whatever you want to call it. But when you tap into it and see where it comes from, right? When you have something that's in your heart that you're really passionate about and that you can put out into the world, somebody wants to hear it. Mm-hmm. It's going to resonate with somebody. And the more you believe in it, the easier it is to put it out there into the world and find those people.
I love that. Thank you, Terry. Andrea, how about you? How does your work help people be well? And then Carmen, we'll hear from you after.
Hello, everyone. Thank you, Terry. Thank you for kicking us off. I think that when it comes to nutrition, it's something that it's our medicine, right? It's where everything starts, our well-being. So I really appreciate the work that you do. Similar to Terry, I work with the mind, with making sure that people understand what is their mental state, understanding their emotions. As a mental health coach, I work a lot with people that have increased anxiety, depression, stress, for whatever life stressors they're going through. It might be a relationship issue, maybe a career transition. Sometimes these things that are external, they can trigger all kinds of negative emotions. They can trigger all kinds of thinking traps that kind of keep us stuck. I started my career as a coach, as a leadership coach, and doing more executive. But then as I think I progressed and I understood that in order for somebody to be able to reach their highest potential, they need to take a step back and kind of understand how they function. Like, who am I? We are constantly sold the ideal of who we need to be, what we need to achieve in order for us to be happy. And I think that a lot of us sometimes lose ourselves in that pursuit of somebody else's ideal of happiness. So the work that I do it's connected to helping people understand what works for them, what are the thoughts that are healthy, what do they need to accept about themselves, and not necessarily kind of looking at them from the lens of what's wrong with me, but rather what's right with me. What are my values? What are my strengths? And what do I need to connect to and constantly say yes to in order for me to create a life that is fulfilling? It's a very, I'm going to use the same word, but it's a very fulfilling career when you're able to help people come back home, come back to that place in which they feel, okay, this is me, I feel good, and now I can take on whatever is next and help them achieve their goals. So that's the kind of work that I do as the head coach and founder of Bloom, which is we specialize in helping people with their mental health, but we work with non-clinical clients, meaning I think that traditional therapy, one of the things, and I'm not saying that it's wrong, but sometimes it tells us the story that something's wrong with you, you need to be diagnosed. And a lot of times we're pushed medication when sometimes it's not needed. All you need to do is understand what are the triggers, what are the limiting beliefs that you have, the thinking traps and the emotions that are keeping you feeling, you know, maybe stressed, anxious, or depressed. And in a very short time, we're able to move people forward.
I love that. I hear your master's of applied positive psychology and everything that you just shared. And we're sisters in that way too. Dr. Carmen Gutierrez, will you tell us about the work that you do and how it helps people be well?
Yes, definitely. Again, thank you so much for having me here. I am in great company with Terry and Andrea. A lot of the work that they do goes hand in hand with what I do. I'm in primary care, so primary care encompasses all of that. It encompasses your physical health, your mental health, your nutrition. And my goal in my practice is trying to do a lot of preventative care to prevent diseases such as obesity, hypertension, diabetes, and also at the same time keep someone healthy naturally with, you know, with nutrition, teaching them different options. It's not always the same for everyone. Everybody is different. So as a primary care provider, I kind of have to, well, I do. I develop those relationships with my patients, and that's one of the benefits from me that I've had patients for about 15 years, and they know me, I know them, and I'm able to help them with what they need. And it's very fulfilling when, you know, they thank you, they something motivates them, or they haven't been motivated for years and all of a sudden it clicks after 5 years. And it just takes that one patient really to make your day and make a difference. So I think I'm beyond blessed being in this career, because I'm able to really outreach to a lot of people, a lot of patients, just in different ways, you know. Going back to Andrea about, you know, wellness and mental health, such a huge thing nowadays. It's just incredible what we see, and trying to motivate them themselves and trying to play a part and tell them things need to keep it positive, leave the negative behind, you know, focus on what's good in your life right now. It's just so important. So all these, you know, being a nutritionist and a mental health provider, they all go hand in hand. So sometimes I feel I'm wearing different hats, but I'm blessed to have other people like them to help me along the way.
Yes, I know. I was thinking how it really does take a village to make everybody be well. And Definitely. Not just from one place, and there's not just one source of wellness or well-being, but many people and many practitioners in different forms play a role in that.
Definitely.
Thank you. Carmen, let's start with you. How did you turn your interests into a career?
That's interesting, because I never was exposed to medicine growing up. I didn't have any mentors. There was no forums like this. I didn't know any physicians personally. I didn't know no nurses. So I went to a big university, and it was very large. So I also didn't have like one-on-one advising. It wasn't really until I went. My roommates were all pre-med. And I always had all my activities growing up kind of always, you know, helped in a hospital, volunteer, or help, you know, do some research here and there. They kind of always pointed in that direction, but I never thought that that's what I wanted to do, because I was never exposed to it. So once I realized there was young women like myself going into this field, I felt as though, well, if they can do it, why can't I do it? And I think that's what motivated me on the path. And so I kind of just stuck with it, and I think that's where I hit it, and I'm happy I did. And I couldn't imagine myself being in any other profession but the one I'm in right now.
Love that. Andrea, Terry, how did you turn your interests into a career?
I can go. I think it was my own survival. When I came to this country, I was an immigrant, first generation. I needed, without knowing, without the skills, without the training, I was actually hanging on to some of my strengths and my values when I experienced adversity in order to move forward and survive. And I think that was my kind of like, at 35, I said, I think this is what I'm about. This is my life purpose. Be able to help people move forward, regardless of the circumstances, regardless of the past. How do I empower people to be able to overcome whatever it is that they need to overcome in order to create the life that they want? Because I think that we all deserve it, regardless of what, like I said, how we got started in life. It's never linear. And for some of us, it kind of zigzags into whatever, what we want to accomplish. But I think it was that. It was my own experience, my own need to be able to create the life that I wanted, regardless of what had happened. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I had no idea this career was waiting for me. I had a totally different career path. I was going off in another direction, but my own health was demanding that I pay attention and make some different choices for myself, for my family. And so what I do now was kind of like what I would do on the side after hours. I was everything from educating myself and doing the research and consulting with various people, taking certifications and various different approaches to nutrition and programs all over the country. I was so passionate about it, but I had another 9-to-5 job and I just did it. It was nothing. And then as people started to say, geez, I'm kind of interested in what you're doing there. Could you show me what that stuff is that you're making and take me to the grocery store and show me where it is and tell me about it. And then could you take me home and show me how to cook it? Right. So one day I just said, okay, well, there are people who want to share this and it helps me. That's the thing, is that it, like with everything that I did, the more I shared it, the more support I got, the easier it was to stay the path and stay the course with my own goals. And so I brought people into my home and taught a cooking class. And I was really like, just all of this was on the side. And then it occurred to me that I was putting way more effort into this than anything else. And so I started quite small, but after a few years of teaching in my own kitchen, people started asking me for my recipes. And so I very innocently sent some documents to a friend who was a graphic designer and said, like, do you think we could just bind this somehow? And, I kind of thought, I'm going to date myself, but like, I kind of thought he'd just like make a cool cover and go to Kinko's and photocopy it. Like, and he didn't. And a few years later, I self-published my first cookbook. And it got picked up by a publisher inside of 6 months and was relaunched after that. And it sold almost 200,000 copies and changed my entire life. And everybody has always said to me, like, what was your business plan? And the truth is, like, I was always doing what I was doing, kind of thinking of it then as like how I can give back, you know, what I can give back to like these people who were holding me up and supporting me. It still kind of feels that way. And so, yeah, I mean, there's a little bit of a business plan, but I always believed that if I woke up and did what was in my heart, then it was going to take me to the right place. And I think, the biggest thing I learned was just keep putting one foot in front of the other, because, you don't learn anything if you're standing still. You might go in the wrong direction, but you'll learn something and you'll still move forward, even if you have to change direction. And I've done that a lot of times. When I graduated from college, I was selling dog food. So, I mean, I've made a lot of changes. So I just feel like you just keep putting one foot in front of the other and do what is in your heart. It's going to be received well, even if it's the wrong thing.
Hmm. Love that. So many nuggets in there, Terry. And talk about exploring your interests. That was a true, that was quite the journey of like, okay, this is what's lighting me on fire. This is what I'm interested in. This is what's making me feel good. And that's contagious too. And other people picked up on that. Every day you're just following your flow, your zone of genius and what feels.
Well, let's be honest, because it's a job now too, which means that there are days where I'm doing, you know, work that I really don't like and accounting work. And I mean, there are all sorts of parts to making it a career and making it sustainable. And I don't love every single thing, but I love the greater picture of it. And I learn a lot from the other things too. So, but I think that, you know, it's an honor to have my cookbook in somebody's kitchen. It's an honor for me to know that like it's open on their counter. I'm with them in the kitchen. And I think like food is this great connector, and the food is like just like a really small component of it. It brings us together and it allows us to have the conversations and it allows us to share. And so to me, it feels like that's just a huge honor to be in people's kitchens with them. And you know, I'm pretty out there with my books. Like people know me by the time they're done reading my books. And the reality is they're either going to like me or they're not. Mm-hmm. And both things are okay. You know, it's okay.
I love all of that. Thank you, Terry. Andrea, you must feel similar as being the founder of your own clinic or coaching business, that there are some things that you don't like and some things that you do. So Andrea, when are you in your zone of genius? So when you're doing something that you love to do, that's making a tremendous impact to others.
Yeah. Thank you for that question. Thanks, Terry, for the story. I love it. And I love that you said it's one foot in front of the other, right? Like you just have to take a step by step, because sometimes we have that vision, right, of where we're going or where our heart is taking us. The how, we sometimes just don't know how it's going to happen. But I think when you trust in that what you want is for the good of others, things just begin to align some way or the other. So I think I really want to highlight that, Terry, is that trusting and the not knowing and just kind of following your heart is important. Absolutely, there are ups and downs in being an entrepreneur. I think that I love it when I get to do my thing, when I get to coach, when I get to be in front of my clients, when I get to help them, when I get, you know, to see them kind of with a breakthrough, right? Because a lot of clients come to me and I get them when there's a breakdown, when they're not feeling good. But after 4-6 sessions, kind of them sharing their light and saying, I got it, like I'm ready, like I feel much better now. And it's not something that is not advice, because everything that they're able to tap into is from whatever it is that I just needed to help untap, so they can connect to that. I think that's one of the most fulfilling moments. Obviously there are times that, yeah, I need to, you know, worry about, you know, the administrative stuff of the business. And that can really drain at times, because it's things that are more logistics. You hit a lot of walls. There's a lot of learning that needs to happen. We're still in the growing aspects of the business. So sometimes you do need to wear a lot of hats in order to make things happen. But I think it's those fulfilling moments that keep you going and that create that resilience. And I think it's true also in our lives. Like if we are able to maximize the moments in which we feel good and that we feel connected and that we are in flow and being present to those moments, the times that we feel stuck and that things are not going good or we're having a bad day, we can kind of pull from that reserve that we have of positivity to kind of bring us back. But yeah, I think that when you love what you do and it kind of fits you back in a positive way, I think you can overcome those moments that the road gets a little tough. Yeah. Hope that answers the question, Sophia.
Yeah, no, totally. Love that. Carmen, what about you? When are you in your zone of genius? When you're doing something that you love to do that is making a tremendous contribution to others?
Okay. Well, I'm not an entrepreneur, so I don't think I could ever do that. I've empowered someone to take control of things in their life just to make themselves healthy, or they've kind of, you know, send me an email saying, you know, thank you so much, you know, because of you, this is where I'm at. You know, those little things make a huge difference. Medicine in general is challenging. I'm not going to say it's, you know, full of roses, because it's not. We're busy all the time. We have nice patients and we have some that are not so nice. But then again, you kind of just realize that everybody's coming from a different place, and you treat everyone with respect because you really don't know what's going on at home, or you don't know what happened right before they walk through the door. Just like yourselves, you may be having a bad day, so sometimes you kind of have to step back and just say, hey, you know, one step at a time. But it's just those little moments that make a difference. Or you have that one patient who you know really needs your help, and you know, and they're really there for you and listening to you, and you kind of just take them under your wing and, you know, reassure them, you know, you're gonna be okay. You know, we'll see, you know, I'll get you through this. It just makes a huge, huge difference, and makes those days that are really challenging kind of minute. And, you know, I don't really worry about those or stress about those. Those days are going to be there, and I already know to accept them, but the positive always outweighs the negative.
So when you get that feedback that the work that you've done has changed and helped somebody.
Yeah, that's just, it's just tremendous. Or even when, you know, their family members come to me, I have a lot of age groups, I have, you know, teenagers, women, older, mainly females, and they come with their family members, and their family members are always very appreciative of the care for their parents. So that just feedback, it just makes, you know, a huge difference, because I know I'm making an impact on their lives.
Mm-hmm. That's very rewarding. Thank you, Carmen. Okay, so my last question before we open it up to the audience is, they're all important questions. This one's a very important question to me. So I'd love to hear, Andrea, let's start with you. Andrea, what was the biggest piece of advice that you received on your career journey? And if you had to do it again, what questions might you have asked a mentor sooner?
That's a great question. I think the best piece of advice that I got is you're ready. You're ready now. And sometimes we want to have all of our degrees and certifications ready to start doing the work that we feel passionate about doing. And I remember one of my coaches said, do it now. It's like, regardless, you know, what you're missing, there's somebody out there that can benefit from the knowledge that you have. So, you know, I think that if I can tell any of my mentors or my mentees, I'm sorry, or coaches, is that let's go ahead and focus on what you have right now and how you can start doing the work that you're meant to be doing now. And if I had to go back and ask What was the question, Sophia? Like, if I had to go back and ask what?
What might you have asked a mentor sooner?
Maybe ask for help. I think now that you're asking the question, maybe sometimes I took a little too long to ask for help and to interview people that were already kind of in the path that I was looking to go towards. Really get curious. I think curiosity, you know, 20 years later is like, yeah, I think that being more curious, being more open, having that courage to say, hey, I love what you're doing. And I think I see myself doing that. Do you have 10, 20 minutes that you can sit down with me? I think that would be something that I would go back. I think it would have saved me a lot of time instead of me trying to figure things out on my own.
Nice. Great answer. Thank you, Andrea. Carmen, what about you? What is the biggest piece of advice that you received on your career journey? And if you had to do it again, what questions might you have asked a mentor sooner?
Yeah, I think for me, it was, I guess we go back to, I think someone mentioned earlier, imposter syndrome, thinking that you're not good enough or you're not smart enough, you know, and it's a real thing. I have, you know, daughters too, who feel like that all the time, and just reminding them that they can definitely do it. So I think it's something that I went through in college and just, trying to see if this is something that I could do or couldn't do. Was it beyond my reach? Or, you know, what, can someone like me actually be a physician? But, you know, I had more, my support group was more my family. And for them, their advice was pretty much just go for it. It's, you know, you're, why not? Go for it. Go for what you want if you're passionate about it. The biggest regret will be not doing it. So, I mean, that's what I did. And I think that would be my advice also for anybody else is if you're passionate about something, just go for it. I mean, all you can do, I mean, if you fail, that's, you're just learning from what you didn't achieve and you just keep going and you keep going. So that would be my, you know, advice, just, you know, go for what you want. Why not? There's only one, you're only living one life. There's no, you don't get a do-over. So just go for it at this time.
Awesome. Terry, will you close us out?
I'll try. I have so many notes here, things I want to share, but I'll try and keep it concise. I think I'm not going to call it the best advice, but the advice that stays with me the most is the person who told me not to take it personally. You know, your first book goes out there and you get, like, you know, all these great reviews. And then there's the person that the one review that will haunt you. And sometimes, like, I've had a review on a book about someone who's like, oh, in this book, and it has all of these recipes and she way uses this ingredient. It's not even an ingredient that's in my book. So, you know, they're just out there to get at you. And so I have spent an entire career trying not to take it personally. And every time I think about that, the reality is it's nothing if it's not personal. Everything I do is personal. And I feel like that's exactly what I'm putting out there is what's in my heart and my talent and my approach and all it is personal. And so I feel like that's what I have to give. So that person who always said, you know, don't take it personally, like, it is, it's all personal. And the other advice was from my mother who, like, every time I received something was write a thank you note, write the darn thank you note. And I went through so much stationery as a kid because I had to write them by hand. And if I messed it up, she would make me rip it up. Like, there couldn't be a little error in it. I had to do it over and over and over again. And I feel like the greatest thing I got from that was the ability to communicate. And like, it doesn't matter what you study. If you can communicate in the written, in the verbally, you know, orally, I feel like that can apply to so many different fields. And that was the greatest maybe it wasn't advice, maybe it was just having my hand be forced, but it was certainly the greatest lesson. And if I could go back, I mean, I think asking for help as women in particular, we judge ourselves. I mean, I have a whole career about helping people take judgment out of the food system and not judging themselves. And, you know, it's the last thing we need. And so I think that we judge ourselves that asking for help, it makes us seem weak, and it's just the opposite. My daughter had a teacher who at a conference, parent-teacher conference, when she was in like sixth grade, said, you know, it's not the kids who are struggling that come for extra help. It's the kids who are really smart and want to succeed. And I don't know if she learned from that, but I sure did. I know that we're the panelists here, but I don't want to give that perception that like we've got it down, because it's still hard. Like asking for help is still really hard. And showing that you don't have it all down, and showing that, you know, you're not strong at every part of your job, it's hard to admit it to yourself, let alone to actively go out and say, geez, I'd love your feedback. And how'd I do there? And what are your recommendations? And how do I get from here to there? So I think that asking for help is really, that was a great one. I can't say I had a lot of mentors, but I feel like when you look up to somebody, there are lots of people I look up to. And breathe it in, like just breathe in what it is you love about that person. There's this dancer, like when I started eating like this, there were no healthy cookbooks out there, but there's this dancer, Judith Jameson, who I think is like, I don't know, she just like has rocked my world from the time I knew her. I was probably 11, 12 years old, and she was, you know, on my radar, and there, this incredible dancer, and she's like been my hero for life. And, you know, it's the way she moves through the world. It's the way she conducts herself. It's how she approaches life. It's, I don't know, find that person and breathe that in and find what you love and nourish it in yourself.
Mm-hmm. I love all of that and be unapologetic. Sounds like me with Beyonce. All right. Well, thank you so much. I loved hearing about all of your journeys, exploring your interests and turning them into fruitful careers. And as you continue on your journey to success, we're going to move into breakout rooms. It's that time for our mentoring and networking breakout rooms. So, young adults, 18 to 29, have your questions ready. Some of our panelists will be in the breakout rooms. And then we have other members of the Step Up Network who do also amazing things helping people be well here to answer your questions. So we will go in there and be back in about 25 minutes or so.
All right. Welcome back, everyone. I know we're still waiting for some breakout rooms to close, but I think we're almost all back. I hope you had a great time and as much fun in your breakout room as I did. So at this time, we like to hear from a representative from each group to share a reflection from your breakout room. So we'd love for volunteers. We could start off with my group, maybe a mentor and a young adult. We'd love to hear from each.
I could start. I think something that really like stood out to me was someone asked the question of like, let's say you're like in those like after college and you don't know what you're gonna do in the future. Someone said, write down the list of things you don't want to be, the list of things you don't like. And I thought like that was just something that I'd never heard of. So I thought it was like a really great idea to do that. That way you could like, you know, narrow your options. And then something else I really liked is the importance that I like everyone said, the importance of like self-care and taking it one step at a time. And just like every day is a new day. And especially in healthcare, since like you have a lot of people you see, and everyone has a different story. It's good to just take a step back and, you know, sometimes focus on yourself.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Lulu, for sharing. And thank you, Carla, for sharing in the chat and for your vulnerability in our breakout room. We really appreciate that. Do we have a mentor that wants to share a reflection from my group?
I can say something. I don't know if I'm not a mentor, but I'm a panelist. I'm going to piggyback off what Terry said, and I think this can, maybe you can take it after Terry, but do what fills you up rather than what makes you feel good. I think that's something that I really took. It's that one thing that, you know, you when you are doing it, you know that, oh, this is some, you know, you feel the energy, right? Your energy rises, you feel connected, you feel you're in the flow. I think that's a great sign that that's your thing. And you can stop thinking about it, and you can stop thinking about ideas on what to do next and how to do it. I think that that's one of the things that I take from that session is really feel your own energy, get to know yourself. And obviously, as a mental health coach that works with non-clinical clients, I want to highlight there's nothing wrong with you. If you're feeling sad, down, please look at what actually accept that that's the emotion that you're feeling in that moment, but it's not necessarily a permanent thing and that we need to label you as anything else. It's just what you're feeling and that's it. So that's one of the things that I took from our breakout session. And thank you all. It was great. Always great to be with Step Up family.
Love that so much. Thank you for sharing. I feel like I was cutting someone off. Did someone come off mute? Breakout room two. You can go ahead and share if we have a young adult representative.
Was that us? Okay. So, we talked about finding the thing that gets you excited and that you'll like talk passionately about, and then just like following that, even if you don't know necessarily where it's going to lead. And also about responsibility in your work and taking ownership of that, but also being able to like define where your bounds are with clients, like that you're not responsible for fixing their entire life, or you can't, and that you can't break someone. You can go up to your boundary and that you're safe within there to follow your intuition and make the choices that are informed by your training.
Awesome. Thank you so much for adding that, Bren, and summarizing your breakout group. We have time for one more share out. Any takers? If not, we can move on. Okay, I know we had great conversations. Everybody was talkative in their breakout rooms, just digesting. I know, I get it, I got it. All right, so we can move forward. So now it's time to hear from our 18 to 29 year olds, our young adults. We want to know all about how you are feeling. So we're gonna have some poll questions that are gonna pop up on the screen. And mentors, these are just for young adults. So if you would like to share about your experience, please do email Sophia. Okay, so first question. After this session, how confident do you feel about exploring a career based off of your interests? Does this scale much more than before, equally as much, less than before, or much less? All right, we can go to the next question. Thank you. In which ways did the mentors, both panelists and breakout room mentors, maximize your experience in this session? And this is a select all that applies. So they helped me feel motivated. They helped me learn new skills. They helped me gain access to places and spaces. They helped me in ways not listed here, or they didn't help me in any way. All right, awesome. Thank you so much for sharing. I'm going to pass it over to Aja for some announcements.
Hey, everyone, again. Are you unsure of how to talk about your professional experience concisely or answer the dreaded tell me about yourself question? Have you identified prospective mentors or other professional you're interested in connecting with, but don't know what to say or where to start? In Power Talk on your story, we'll cover how to turn your professional and personal experience into a memorable story to share in the interviews while networking in at any professional event. We'll also share some best practices about how to identify who to connect with and what to say to start those conversations, because who you are and all you have to offer is exactly what we needed in this world. And our next Explore Interests, keep the exploring the going at our next Explore Interests panel, Technology and Innovation. Mentors at this session represent a sector in technology, design, STEM, entertainment, and more. And we'll share a little bit about how their interests guide them to fulfilling career. Mark your calendar, RSVPs will be coming soon.
Awesome, thank you so much, Aja. Have a lot of exciting things coming up and we hope to see you there. Special thank you to our sponsor, Visible, and thank you all for joining us today. I hope you enjoyed learning so much about careers with helping others be well, as I did, and enjoyed this time together growing your professional network. We look forward to seeing you all soon. Have a great evening, everyone. Let me give myself a hand.